I'm Giorgio Metta. I'm from the Italian Institute of Technology, a research institute based in Genoa, Italy, and I work on human robotics, and in particular I'm the coordinator of the iCub project. Today I'm going to speak about the iCub, human robotics project developed by the Italian Institute of Technology, and I'd like to start from sort of a piece of science fiction that has been taken from iRobot, a book by Isaac Asimov, and which I think it gives the perspective of where we'd like to see robotics, especially human robotics, in the near future. So the sentence goes a bit like this. There are two people talking. One person asks to the other one, "How old are you?" And the second person replies, 32. And the first person again commenting says, "Oh, then you don't remember a world without robots," meaning that it was a time, so that there was this young person that didn't ever see a robot or a world where the robots weren't present. A bit like, you know, our kids don't know a world without computers, without telecommunication devices, and so forth. I think this was, I think it's a nice passage in the book because it really reminds me of, I don't know, my son interacting with music, and he only knows digital music. There was never a time for him where the music was analog or before actually were able to manipulate things so continuously. And I think it may be the same for robotics. And what we're doing is actually trying to contribute to this vision of bringing robotics to the daily life. And in particular, when you do humanoids, you have to think of the reasons why you're doing humanoids. And for us, as I'm gonna show you in the next slide, it's basically make a dream come true. And this dream is of robots that work with people, alongside with people, and actually one day we'll reach our homes, basically. So we'll have robots everywhere, including our homes. This picture shows, well, first of all, has been taken pretty much randomly from the internet. It's just a Google image. And I like it because everybody's smiling. So it's a kind of a positive view of robotics. And there are, I mean, number of applications that can be seen in the image. There are robots going autonomously, or robots helping people and interacting with people, and they seem to be talking to each other. And so there's a natural interface, like a speech-based interface, and the robots are actually accomplishing something useful, like assisting a person that has reduced mobility, or simply taking care of the daily chores at home. So what is our contribution to this view? It's the iCub. The iCub is a human robotics project, as I mentioned. It started initially as a European project in 2004, so it's now more than 10 years that we're working on this specific platform. And as any other robotics project, it started basically from our desire to build a machine for our own research. And in particular, we were missing a robot with hands and a robot with the capability of moving the cameras very efficiently, so a full humanoids in a sense. I mean, the robots that were available off the shelf, either they had simplified hands so they can really manipulate the environment, or they had fixed cameras, so they weren't the ideal human robotics platform. And that's how we basically started designing it. In the coming years, we also made the project open source. Many people started using the iCub as a platform for their own research. And at the moment, we have about 30 robots distributed, as I said, open source in different research institutes and universities, mostly in Europe, because the project started here, but also in Japan, in Korea, in US. So I think this now the most available human robotics platform, so that there's no other robots of this complexity that can actually be obtained, let's say, from us. It's also, well, the fact that it's open source doesn't mean it's cheap. It's a very expensive platform. It costs about $250K, which in a sense limits diffusion. And later I'll be discussing about these aspects, especially the fact that technology per se is super expensive because of, not only because of the fact that we're building only a few robots, but also because of the type of technology that we use now for robotics is super expensive. So the robot has 53 degrees of freedom, which means the body, especially the upper body, is quite articulated. We have a lot of motors moving the hands, for instance. So supposedly the hands are very dexterous. It weighs about 29 kilograms, which is, despite the size of the robot being only that of a 5 years old, the weight is that of a 10 years old. So it's kind of a chubby child. The reason is that the materials that we use, the electric motors and the mechanics in general, is heavier than what we will expect. It's also a very complex platform. It's made of about 5,000 parts, which means that many things can go wrong, in the sense that there are many components that can actually break at each given instant of time, which is also another, you know, thinking of the future when the robots will be at home. Certainly they will need to be simpler, in a sense, or made of less parts, so where the level of reliability that is needed is much higher. 5,000 parts is about the number of the parts of a small car, so that's also puts this type of research in perspective. In the following graph, for instance, we can see the different the number of parts of different types of, let's say, devices or machines created by men. And as you can see, the iCub, it's kind of in between a 3D printer and a family car. But that it's not new to humans to actually build machines that are more complicated. If you take, the 747 airplane, that's 6 million parts. So it's much more complicated. But also the type of maintenance you do, it's much more accurate. While for human robotics, it has eventually to be working with people. You don't want to be fixing the robot every couple of days. So the idea is that as the number of parts increases, also the number of failures may increase. And we have to really consider the structure of technology to make it more reliable. This, as I said, is a question for the future, but a very important one if this technology has to become available. So why we believe the iCub is special? As I said, I mentioned the hands. That's certainly a unique feature. There's also another number of, let's say, design decisions that we've taken with the iCub. For instance, we decided not to use sensors that are, not human. So what we done was to focus on human-like sensors. We don't have lasers, for instance. At the same time, we have cameras, and we have two of them, so we can see the world in 3D. We have microphones, we have inertial sensors, and I think quite uniquely on the iCub, we have tactile sensors. Tactile sensors, cameras can be just bought off the shelf, but tactile is technology that didn't exist before we actually designed something specifically for the iCub. And I'll go through that later, because this it's a very important component of a robot that has to interact with people, because having a sensorized skin, allows of a very natural human-robot interaction. You can push the robot, you can touch the robot, and the robot will be aware of the fact that there's something that is touching it, or there's action to be taken to avoid touch in certain situations. Another thing we've done for the iCub was to design a custom electronics to control the motors, and this was done to give maximum flexibility to the researchers so they're able to program, if they want, the very low level of the controller, so the robot. This initially was sort of less important, but now that we're doing very sophisticated control strategies, having the ability to control even the lowest possible level of the control chain makes for additional flexibility. Again, for research, this is important. The last point, let's say, or the last set of design decisions that we've taken along the project was to make open source. And this is important for reasons of diffusion of the platform, and also since we always tackling very complicated problems, to be able to reuse research done by other people. So we sort of created a small community. We're maybe about 200 researchers working on the iCub now. And the fact that we are community allows for much faster debugging, for basically building a critical mass in themes that are very, very difficult, so which are in general those of autonomous robotics. At the moment, for instance, our software repository counts more than 2 million lines of C++ code, and which doesn't mean much about the quality of the software, but it tells you of the fact that the community is very alive. I mean, there are lots of students contributing to the platform itself. The other question we may ask is why we're building human robots. There are certainly scientific reasons connected to the study of intelligence, or especially of artificial intelligence. I'd like to cite a paper here by Rodney Brooks, very well-known researcher at MIT, now actually retired, but I think it was in the 90s, published a paper titled Elephants Don't Play Chess, meaning that the type of intelligence you may develop in a robot depends very much on the shape of the body. And so to develop human-like intelligence, you have to have a human-like body. I mean, this has been proven afterward also in neuroscience. I mean, the discovery of the fact that, for instance, perception is very much connected to action, and especially the motor signals in the brain determine the way we perceive the environment and how we perceive objects, how we perceive movement and so forth. So meaning that how we move determines how we perceive the world, and this becomes again a reason for having movement that is human-like. Being human-like, facilitates natural human-robot interaction. This again has been proven through, for instance, behavioral experiments in robots interacting with people. And the fact that robots moved in a certain way determined a better performance in the realization of shared tasks. And of course, a robot that is humanoid can share really the environment with us, because it can use the same tools, can move in the same space, and it makes really the entire world available to the robot. So it's not just a robot. The robot learns to use tools, then those tools are immediately the same tools that have been designed for humans. For us also, doing humanoids has been a very challenging project. From the engineering point of view, designing the robot required squeezing the electronics to small size, but also fit all the motors that we needed in the shape of a person, which is easy. And this determines, for instance, the overall shape of the robot. The fact we have hands determines where you place the motors, which sort of requires using certain technologies for the various joints. For instance, since the motors can be placed anywhere, what we had to do was to route or to use tendon-driven actuation, which is a very specific choice in the mechanics of robotics. And last but not least, I think this project has been a lot of fun. From the engineering point of view, building something so challenging, it's, let's say, something that stimulates also the students, also our researchers, to go beyond what was available. So we have many original solutions on the mechanics of the robot that was designed just because we had the requirements of making a humanoid robot.